Welcome to Subterraneans. We bring you Christine Shields, amazing visual artist and musician. We are in her beautiful live work space right now, and we are going to indulge in Christine's world. Hello, Christine.
Hello, Sarah.
My first question for you, which is something I ask a lot of people because the answers are always so fascinating. When and how did you discover, did you realize that you were going to be an artist, that this was something that you were meant to do, that you were going to commit yourself to doing? If you can recall a specific moment that really stands out to you, what would that be?
So when I was probably about just old enough to start having memories, I lived on a ranch in Watsonville that had forests on it. And my babysitter took me on a walk through the forest. It was beautiful, lots of trees. And anyway, I found a nut that fell on the ground. I think it was a walnut. Mm-hmm. And I was about three. I loved my babysitter. Christina was her name. And I got this idea in my head that maybe this nut could be turned into a doll. And I thought, this nut looks like a head. So I handed the nut to her and I said, can you make this into a doll or a person? And she took the nut and we finished our walk and we went back to her really charming little place where I believe she had like an old treadle sewing machine. Mm-hmm. And she sat and sewed a little doll body with clothes, with a dress. And I don't even know how she attached the head. But suddenly there was this little person, and it felt like it was alive, and it felt really magical. And that's when I sort of realized that you could take things and make something.
Yes.
So,
like an imprint of your psyche that you can hold in your hand.
And it felt like a little person that was real. So, and it was made out of stuff from nature.
Yeah.
So that was one thing that really stuck out to me, and I was like, my God, it worked. And I thought that Christina had magic powers. Mm-hmm. So that was one thing. Then I had a mother who drew a lot, and I just started drawing as soon as I could, drawing, and also I was really into learning how to do cursive. That was a big deal for me.
Yes, cursive. I remember that.
So I would make fake grocery lists because I saw my mom doing that. And I would draw animals and people. But then another sort of epiphany moment when I actually knew what my calling was in life, I guess, was that at some point my parents, we lived near Santa Cruz, purchased for me this very strange item, which was an inflatable teepee. So it was made out of like the same kind of plastic, like a pool toy or a pool toy or like a inflatable toy would be made out of. And it had, so the structure of the teepee was like tubes that made a cone. Mm-hmm. And then it had this big plastic like printed teepee cover.
Right. Like and, Navajo style.
Yeah, it was very weird, and possibly somebody would take offense to such a thing. But to me, this was like my magic hut that I would meditate in. And during one of these meditation sessions, I had this epiphany. The epiphany was, when I grow up, I am going to be an artist and a witch doctor. I knew the word witch doctor, but I didn't have any reference within my family for any kind of anything mystical, really. But I was always really attracted to that sort of thing, and I always had really strange dreams since early childhood. And I just had this sense that that was for me, was to be this witch doctor, which I guess I thought was like a mystical type of person. So it was that mixed with being an artist. And
So you were like a weenie witch in your plastic teepee.
Yeah.
And then became a visionary.
Oh, well, thank you.
So I remember when you started doing professional illustrations, you did the cover of Screw magazine in New York City. A lot of other great stuff since then. But you also do, in the last few years, you've done these amazing series of faces. that knowing your background and knowing how you think and knowing what really gets you excited, and, you know, there's this like this mystical world that you inhabit. What's the calling? How do they manifest? If you can even answer that.
I can. I'll try not to make it too long-winded, but yeah. First, just a little background is that I went to art school for painting, but I did a lot of other stuff in art school.
At the Art Institute in San Francisco.
That's right. And I was very serious about becoming a painter, but then I moved to New York, where you and I were roommates, and I always just did whatever I had to do, because... you know, none of us ever had any money.
Make that cash.
And we just had to hustle and do whatever we had to do. And so right before leaving San Francisco and going to New York, I started to do more illustrative type of stuff because it was the early 90s and the whole zine thing was really taking hold.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of my friends were doing zines. And so I was doing a lot of drawings for stuff like that, Flatter, and a bunch of other things. So I was doing that kind of stuff, and I started doing comics and fell in with a bunch of comic book artists and was doing my own comics for a while. And anyway, I didn't mean to get so off track here. Let me reel it in a bit. But I'm saying that I thought I was going to be a painter, but then I ended up getting all this illustration work in New York, like for the New York Press and stuff, and I learned... kind of a whole new set of skills for doing this professional drawing work.
Yeah.
And then I went on and did all these other kinds of things. Let's see, can you repeat the question?
Absolutely.
Oh, the faces.
Yes.
Okay. So I have worn a lot of hats within being a person who draws and paints. Murals, comics, illustration, paintings. Just like everything you can imagine. I like high-end specialty painting for rich people's houses and stuff. And then when I lived back in San Francisco, I'm skipping way ahead.
Right.
In the the early aughts, I guess. I had 2 years, at the Headland Center for the Arts, which is the most amazing place to have a studio. Mm-hmm. It's right by the ocean. And I started doing a series of paintings, real portraits of real people, mostly musicians and artists in San Francisco. And these were like serious paintings, like large paintings of real people. And I did that for a while, and I thought I would continue to do that, but I didn't.
Is that the time period when you painted that portrait of the red man?
Yes.
So, quick diversion.
Okay.
The red man was a man in the mission.
Yes.
Who hung out at Cafe Picaro on 16th between Valencia and Guerrero.
And the Latin American Club.
Yeah, and the Latin American Club. But this cafe society was still alive and well in the mission at the time. A lot of people just hang out, and everybody knew the red man because he was this, looked a bit like a Roma gypsy kind of character with a pencil mustache, but he painted his entire, all the skin you could see, he painted red. Every day. I saw him. I just didn't know how to process it.
Yeah.
And after a while, I would start looking for him whenever I'd be in the neighborhood because I just was so fascinated by him. And then one night, I walked into Adobe Books, and there was a painting of the red man. And that just blew my mind. Of course, I had to ask you about it. So anyway, you started doing portraits.
Yes, and I'm happy to talk more about the Red Man later, too, because he is such a fascinating... He's now moved on to another dimension.
Yes.
He already was sort of half in another dimension.
But he has left this world.
He's gone now. Gone but not forgotten. But I did these portraits. And then, over time, I kind of felt that I didn't really... You know, I really, really appreciate artists like Alice Neel is one of my favorite portrait artists, and I thought maybe I could go that way in my life and really do that. I got a lot of satisfaction out of it, but it really wasn't to be, and I found sort of a frustration with doing these portraits of real people at some point. It's hard to explain why, but...
Do you feel like you had to pander to people's vanities, or could you be honest and real?
Well, you know, I did, because I was always doing a mix of my own art that that I just wanted to do, and commissions. I had also done a lot of commissions for portraits. I did a lot of children's portraits for a while, and that was easy because everybody just, their kids are cute and they love them.
Yeah.
And that's no big deal. Animals and children, easy, you know, and fun. As soon as you're doing adults, they are very nervous about how they're portrayed, and I am guilty of this as well.
This is why I don't videotape my interviews.
Yes.
Because people are more comfortable talking than being seen.
Definitely. So I totally understand it, but the other thing is, they're not, even if they're really good portraits, unless you're already a super famous artist or the people in the paintings are famous, people don't really want to buy portraits of just real people.
Right, unless it's of themselves.
Yeah, which would maybe be a commission, but so I just went through some confusion over that, and I'm very sensitive, and when people are not happy with something I make, I probably like take it a little too hard. For better or for worse, I have had a hard time just sticking to one thing and like kind of coming up with my shtick and sticking to it for years and years and years, which is more natural for some people. And it's also, really, it's more lucrative because people want to know who you are. They like repetition. They like to know you're the person that does this.
Right.
But I'm the kind of person that I need to grow all the time. I can't just settle into something because it's what the public wants or whatever.
That's not who you are. You're a nomad. You're a wild child. I mean...
That's right.
You know, that's just part of you.
But at the same time, my need, my curiosity about life, my need to grow, that is what has to come first. I can never feel like, oh God, I make this again.
Right.
I have to feel like, oh, this is exciting to me.
Well,
so,
I mean, you got one life.
Yeah.
And it doesn't last that long. Seems like it does, but years fly by the older you get, so you might as well do what you love, right?
Yeah.
So tell me about the faces. What state of mind are you in when those faces come out? Who are they? Do you know them? Are they spiritual things? Are they dreams?
Well, yes to all those things, but the reason that the faces came about was a fluke in a way, because a few years ago, I landed back in San Francisco, a city that just has reeled me back in time and again. I did a residency at Adobe Books, which was a place I had worked at before and who I had a lot of community through that place. They reformed as a collective and they were offering a very kind of humble art residency. It was a month of using their back room. So it was basically a table by a window.
Yes.
So I had had painter's block for quite a while, and I was really suffering over it. It was disturbing my mind. I was like, why can't I paint? What's wrong with me? And I was just really stuck, and I was going through a big heartbreak, and I was just kind of lost. So I thought, well, I have a table, I have some paint, and I don't know what to do, but I'd like to do something that gets me through this painter's block. So, and I can't work very large, you know.
Well, space is impossible to find sometimes when you need it.
But it was a very pleasant room to be in with a nice window and good light.
Who doesn't love rooms full of books?
Yeah, I actually really like being around books. I had heard from a friend about doing classes with Linda Barry, the comic artist and writer. Wonderful, wonderful comic artist. And Linda Barry used different methods to help get unstuck. Really geared towards writing, but also drawing. So one of the techniques for the writing was to just get an hourglass, turn it over, and just start writing stream of consciousness. And I was like, that's really smart, because really, for me, a lot of the times, I just don't know how to start.
Yep.
You know, and I get stuck in that little I can't start place. I think it's very common for a lot of people. And I thought, well, this is brilliant, because you're not doing this hour of free-form writing to impress anybody or get a job done. You're just jumping off and taking the risk of just doing whatever comes out. And then, of course, the magic is, once you've started, you want to keep going.
You can't stop.
I thought, well, there must be some way I can specialize this technique towards painting. So I bought a fancy hourglass, one that I would like and get excited about. And I had a stack of papers that was pre-cut. I had cut to 7 by 7 inches from some forgotten art project that never happened. Mm-hmm. And it was very nice quality paper. And I was like, well, I have these squares. And I'm like, I have this paint, I have these squares of paper, and I have this hourglass. What could I do? And my objective was, I want to feel joyful in my art practice again, like when I was a kid.
Yes.
You know, like when
back
I...
Back to the teepee, young witch. Go back.
Yes, and back to, like, finding the nut on the ground and be like, this is a person's head, and, you know. And so speaking of heads, like, I've always been a doodler when I'm at jobs or things, and I've doodled, and sometimes my doodles are really just as good as, like, my serious art, because I'm more playful, because they're not for anybody, I'm not trying to impress anyone, and they're really free and loose and silly. Sometimes my sense of humor doesn't come out in my paintings, but in the doodles, you know, it does. And I thought, well, there's something in that. What is really easy for me that's just going to be...
It's going to get your engine.
Yeah, and I was like, well, faces. I obsessively have drawn faces and over since childhood. And I thought, that's it. I'm going to draw faces. I'm going to paint them on these pieces of paper. And I devised a way to lay out 9 of these squares in a grid, get my paint set up, turn over the hourglass, and just go as fast as I could and not think. Like a meditation, you know, just come back to the piece of paper. Don't think about it. And I would be like, this one's going to be a pink face. This one will be green. And then one would dry, and I'd grab another one. And I just get these sort of notions like, that one now needs teal colored hair. And this one needs some red lips. And they would, it's almost like they would make themselves. Wow. They would tell me what they wanted next. Mm-hmm. I'm also incredibly excited about color. Color is almost like a drug for me.
Yeah.
And color is a lot like music to me. I think if I'd grown up in a different culture, I might be synesthetic, because there's these different ways of creating, or the different senses are so alike to me. Colors, putting colors together is a lot like putting harmonies or notes together. I was just getting kind of high off doing whatever colors I wanted. Just like anything. And these paints that I have, you know, I like every color of paint, I could just go mad. So I just started doing it, and I couldn't believe how happy I was. My painting block's over. I started making these faces. I never made them to exhibit. I just wanted to paint again, and I wanted to be happy.
Yes.
That was my objective. But then what happened was these sort of creatures, these characters started just coming through me out onto the page. And I was totally surprised by who they were. I was like, oh, look at that one. Like, I was very charmed by them. Not because I painted them, but like, oh, who is that?
Yeah.
And, you know, to me, and I found, like, to people who see them, there's something about them that feels really real. A human quality.
You're seeing a spirit come through.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, and that's why I wanted to ask you about them, because they're some of my favorite things that you've done. I mean, I love all your work that I've ever seen, but the faces, I just never get tired of looking at them, especially in a grouping where you can see all of them at once.
Oh, thank you. Well, I ended up having a show with them at Adobe when the residency was wrapping up, and people just really responded to them in this really happy way, in a way that was really different from my other portraits. I wish I could remember. One person said it really well, and I'm not going to say it as well, but basically what they were expressing was that they were like portraits of human qualities.
Yeah.
Instead of portraits of certain people. And so it seemed that gave it this more universal appeal. Because even though it wasn't anyone in particular, there's certain ones where you know that person.
Yeah. You're
like, oh, that is so much like someone I would know. Or
yeah.
And then the other thing that would happen is they can be hung in different configurations and grids and strips. But depending on which portrait is hanging by which portrait, people would come in and they'd start to talk about, like, to each other about, oh, this is what's going on between these two people. And so their imaginations were triggered to make up stories about who these people were.
Their relationships with each other.
Yeah. And then they started selling, and people would take them home, and I feel like they were my little sort of children that I'm sending off into the world. And I'm really happy to know that they're with people.
Joy. Yeah.
You know, and some of them are quite dark, actually. You know, some of them, I'm excited when some people I know buy a more challenging one. You know, right. Because they're not all happy. Some of them are. They're all different.
But the human spirit is multifaceted, and we're dark as well, and we're light. And that's a theme that comes up in almost every interview, is like going into the dark side and embracing it.
Yes.
And finding what's interesting there.
Yeah, which has been a huge part of my life.
Not only do you do all this visual art with paints and things, but you also did this incredibly unique project, Granny's Empire of Art, which is a house in Potrero Hill in San Francisco, has been cultivated as an art piece in itself. You were commissioned to do this incredible mosaic. The bathroom. And I've been in the bathroom, which feels very special because this bathroom is, I have no words for it.
But, you can Google it.
Well, you're probably looking at a picture of it right now. You need to see this bathroom.
Oh, of course, yeah.
But tell us about that. What was that like for you working in a different medium? How did it inspire you or inform you as an artist going forward from that whole experience? Because that was a big body of work that you did.
That was a long job, yeah. Well, I'll just give as brief as possible of a little background here. Jaina B., the person that habitates Granny's Empire of Art and is Granny, is a dear friend that I had first gone to the Art Institute with. And over the years, we became very close. And Granny's is this really unique art project that's a house. That's actually two houses. And I had done other projects there. I had painted stuff, helped with decorating and designing things there. So then redone. And somehow it turned into this really elaborate project, which if you're looking at the picture right now, you'll see it's entirely made of glass mosaic. And the only things that Jaina wanted were, the description was, let me get it right, the yellow submarine crash lands in Gaudí's beach house.
Okay, let's repeat that while looking at the beautiful images. The yellow submarine crash lands in Gaudí's beach house. I mean, of course, who doesn't want that in their bathroom?
Yeah.
And I know I do.
Otherwise, it was like, go forth and do what you will with this. And so I didn't do this project alone. A lot of people worked on it. Jason Mecier, who's an amazing artist that I've known since I was 14, because we're both from the Nevada City area, worked on it with me for a long time. And then the wonderful artist, Kate Fenker, came aboard and did a bunch of really beautiful mosaic there as well. So it, all of us worked on it, plus the plumber Marco and our friend Jenny B, who did the lighting. So a lot of people worked on this. Anyway.
How did it inform you going forward with your art, having that experience of working in a different medium?
Well, I just want to say I never did mosaic. Either had Jason.
So it was your first time, both for both of you.
Yeah. I mean, Jason's work is more like mosaic anyway, but just made out of stuff.
Yeah.
Like any kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. But I had never done any mosaic before. But, you know, I'm just like, okay, what's the medium? Figure out how to use it. And so we just learned how to do it. And there for like 3 years.
3 years, yeah.
So honestly, I have never again done mosaic.
Wow, so that was just a one-off.
Yeah, I would like to. I really like it, but I'm really more of a painter. I like things that feel fluid, mm-hmm. You know, instead of like chopping and cutting.
Little pieces, yeah.
I like to feel like things are fluid.
So speaking of fluidity, you're also a musician. So you've been in a bunch of bands. I can vouch that music has been a huge part of your life because I was there with you.
Yeah.
Going to shows.
Great shows, yeah.
Since we were little teenage, you know. Well, no, I met you when I was 19.
We were still teenagers then.
Yeah, but a lot of shows.
Oh, yeah.
A lot of different shows. We went to everything. That's what people did. So tell me about the music you're playing now, and are you going to play a song for us at the end of this interview?
I will play a song for you at the end of the interview. So the music I'm playing now, it can be put into the psych folk category.
Yeah.
But like music was a big deal for me, especially since really, you know, my whole life I took music lessons a little as a kid. And I danced a lot. I just liked to do everything creative, basically. But yes. I had to pick a couple things. And I always liked to sing. I sang in the choir as a kid. And then I was in this wild band called Archipelago Brewing Company with my housemates when I first moved to San Francisco and played drums very badly.
I saw you play on Halloween once.
It was really fun being in that band. It was just wild. And then I learned how to play the banjo. Old time music, but was always interested in every genre of good music I could get my hands on. And really, even in art school, I was more interested. I mean, I was serious about my work, but I was really, my community was a little bit more through like the rock scene, like going to music shows. It's a huge part of my life. I love music. Probably more than anything. And I really can't live without it. I have to listen to it while I'm painting. I have to sing whenever I feel like it. And but anyway, now I mainly play guitar and sing. And I play a few other instruments too. I play a little keyboards and stuff.
Can you tell us about the show in LA that you're going to be playing soon?
My friend Jovi Schnell, who's an amazing painter and a great singer, has started working with the LA Arboretum, which happens to be the place that they shot the intro to Fantasy Island.
The plane!
So I'm excited to play in this fancy, magical place. My friend's band, Strawberry Smog, who I also sometimes play with, is going to play. And I will see.
Fun.
Hopefully we'll set up a few shows around that date, which is June 29th.
Is there anything else that you would like to share? Anything at all about you?
Well, I mean, I don't know how to talk about it very succinctly, I guess, but a lot goes into my creative practice. I've been really interested in this sort of bridge between this world and what you might call the dream world or the spirit world. And that has been, somehow that's part of my path in life and what I have to offer. I can make a space through the music, through the art, people to connect. I've just really come to a place where, just to really hone it down into the simplest thing, that there are two major forces in this sort of binary reality that we live in. Mm-hmm. And one is fear and one is love. It's very taboo. It's becoming less so, but when I was going to art school, it was very taboo to talk about or anything spiritual. And so I kind of kept my mystic world to myself. Times are really changing right now because people are in so much pain, and I am too, and I've had to do a lot of healing to find a way to talk about this and what it means to have that in one's art practice.
Save you.
Yeah.
As the doer and as the receiver.
That's the place that I can go to connect again when I'm feeling scared and I'm feeling isolated. I went through a lifelong struggle which was why I would become blocked. And I'm bringing this up because I've really used my creative path to bring about that kind of healing for myself. And, you know, it does work. It does work.
It does work.
And I've been in some very dark places. It's not like my life is perfect now and I got it all figured out. This is going to be my lifelong work. There really is the possibility of transforming your reality.
What it sounds like to me is that gift of healing that you gave yourself by engaging in your creative practice created a byproduct, which is the art itself, which was a gift to others.
Yes. And thank you. I like it. And I feel like the luckiest person in the world for all the wonderful friends I have like you, Sarah.
Thank you so much, Christine.
Thank you.
We are going to listen to a song.
Okay. Okay, I just have to remember how to start it.
Okay, go ahead.
Mm-hmm.
Can